The goal of today is to graph a special family of equations which give rise to what we call quadric surfaces. Before we see quadric surfaces, let's take a look at these four warm-up questions. So the first one is, what type of object is x squared plus y squared equals 4 in the xy plane? Just in R2. The next question is, what is the shape of 3x squared plus 2y squared equals 1 in the xy plane? And what is 2x squared plus 3y equals 1 in the xy plane? And lastly, what is x squared minus y squared equals 1? The first one is a circle of radius 2 centered at the origin. The next one is an ellipse. 2x squared plus 3y equals 1 is a parabola. And lastly, x squared minus y squared equals 1 is a hyperbola. These are what we call conic sections. If you're rusty on conic sections, you might want to pause this video and spend a few minutes reviewing them because we will use this information in order to graph quadric surfaces. So I'm going to assume that you're familiar with circles, ellipses, parabola, and hyperbola. We're going to start looking at quadric surfaces by examining the equation z equals x squared plus y squared. We can think of this as the function f of x and y equals x squared plus y squared, which makes it a scalar valued function of two variables like we saw in the previous lecture. We would like to graph this function or graph the equation z equals x squared plus y squared using the method of finding cross sections. So what a cross section is you take one of the values for the variables. We're going to take z cross sections for this example. And you say, suppose I set z equal to 0, what would x and y look like in order to make the equation true? And the answer is if z equals 0, then we need x and y so that x squared plus y squared equals 0. There's no choice here, it has to be the origin. So then I come over to the graph in xyz space and I look in the plane z equals 0. So that of course is the familiar xy plane down here at the bottom, kind of like the floor of this picture. And I say, in this plane, this is part of the graph of the equation. Next, what would x and y be in order to satisfy the equation x squared plus y squared equals 1? In other words, what would the z equals 1 cross section look like? And that, of course, is the unit circle for x and y. So I'm going to graph the unit circle, but then I'm going to put it in the plane z equals 1. The next two I'll just do out loud. When z equals 2, x squared plus y squared equals 2 defines the circle of radius square root of 2. That would be happening in the plane z equals 2. When z equals 3, we're looking at the circle of radius 3 graphed in the plane z equals 3, radius square root of 3, etc. So as we go up in z values, we're just defining circles. You can graph several of these. It's not totally clear based on this picture what exactly the shape that results is. So let's also look at two other cross sections. Let's look at the cross section x equals 0. When x equals 0, all of the action is happening in the yz plane, and when I plug x equals 0 into this equation, I get z equals y squared. So that, of course, is a parabola. Similarly, if I look at the cross section y equals 0, then we're in the xz plane, and we're looking at the parabola z equals x squared. So that looks kind of like that. So by looking at a handful of cross sections, here we did a few cross sections for z, as well as the cross sections x equals 0 and y equals 0, we start to piece together the shape that the graph of z equals x squared plus y squared would take. The graph of this equation is what we call a paraboloid, and it's the first quadric surface that we're seeing today. The name paraboloid is obviously emphasizing that if you just look at how z relates to either x or y, you get parabolas. It's not just true when x equals 0, it's true for any x value. So if you set x equal to 5, z equals 25 plus y squared is a parabola in terms of y and z. So this is the classic paraboloid z equals x squared plus y squared. All of the cross sections around the z-axis are perfectly circular, but you could have something like z equals 2x squared plus 3y squared. That would be an elliptic paraboloid. You could also interchange the role of x, y, and z, or you could have z equals negative x squared minus y squared. That would be a paraboloid opening down. So there are ways to tweak the terms in this expression in order to get different parabolic shapes. Let's look at a similar equation, which is z equals the square root of x squared plus y squared. Once again, let's go through a few cross sections for z, and then we'll also do the x equals 0 and y equals 0 cross sections. When z equals 0, we need x squared plus y squared to be 0. So once again, that's just the origin in the xy plane. When z equals 1, x squared plus y squared would have to be 1. So once again, we're looking at the unit circle in the plane z equals 1. So far, it's the same as the cross sections that we found for the paraboloid, but now it's going to be different. When z equals 2, we would need x squared plus y squared to be 4. So that's a circle of radius 2 located in the plane z equals 2. That's a circle with a bigger radius than what we found for the cross section z equals 2 in our study of the paraboloid. Now I've gone up to the plane z equals 2 and tried to sketch a circle that really has a radius of twice the previous circle. Likewise, in the plane z equals 3, when we look at this cross section, x squared plus y squared equals 9, so we're looking at a circle of radius 3. Okay, so there's our cross section corresponding to the slice z equals 3. So I think of each of these circles as tracing out the curve of intersection if I were to take the eventual graph of this equation and slice into it at different z altitudes. Okay, now let's consider the cross section x equals 0. When x equals 0, z equals the square root of y squared. A lot of people want to say, oh, that's just z equals y, but it's not, because y could be positive or negative. So this is z equals the absolute value of y. So that means I need to sketch that v-shaped absolute value function in the yz plane. Okay, that looks like that. Similarly, when y equals 0, z equals the square root of x squared, which is the absolute value of x. Okay, so that looks like that. So this has some similarities to the paraboloid, but it's a different shape. And you can probably guess what we're going to call this shape, with a slight caveat. It's a cone, but actually I'll show you the real cone, what we call a cone, a little later. I would call this a single cone. So this cone is the graph of z equals the square root of x squared plus y squared. You could also have an elliptic cone that's not perfectly circular around the z-axis. So you could have something like z equals the square root of 2x squared plus 5y squared, or you could interchange the roles of x, y, and z. But this is the classic single cone. Now let's graph z squared equals x squared plus y squared. We actually don't have a lot of work to do here because I claim that this is just going to generalize the previous example. So in particular, if z is greater than or equal to 0, then this equation is equivalent to z equals the square root of x squared plus y squared. If z is negative, then this equation is z equals negative the square root of x squared plus y squared. The first option we already sketched. That was our single cone opening up. When z is negative, we just reflect that shape over the xy plane to negate all the z values. So we get the same shape but opening down. So this is like a double cone. It's what I usually mean when I say the word cone. So z squared equals x squared plus y squared gives us the cone opening up and the cone opening down. It's like the double cone versus the single cone. This is another one of our quadric surfaces. So we've seen the paraboloid and now the cone. Let's look at another one. Okay, let's graph z equals x squared plus y squared using cross sections in x and y. So first predict the shape that these cross sections would take. So if I plug in x equals 0 or x equals plus minus 1 or plus minus 2, what kind of shape do we get? And then same questions, but plugging in y equals 0, y equals plus minus 1 or y equals plus minus 2. If we plug in x equals 0, we would be looking at the parabola z equals minus y squared in the yz plane. That looks like this. And then whether x is positive 1 or negative 1 in the equation, that's going to have the effect of taking this parabola and shifting it up 1 unit. So that we would be looking at z equals 1 minus y squared, both located in the plane x equals 1 and in the plane x equals negative 1. So that's this pair of parabolas. And then similarly, when x is plus or minus 2, we just take that parabola and shift it up again. So these two parabolas are now happening in the planes x equals 2 and x equals negative 2. So those are 5x cross sections. Once we have the full graph of this equation, these are the curves of intersection that we get when we slice into them with z equals constant planes. Now what about when y equals 0? Here the action is happening in the xz plane, and when y equals 0, we're just looking at the classic z equals x squared up opening parabola. Then when we let y equal plus or minus 1 or plus or minus 2, that's going to take the parabola and shift it down. So this parabola is happening in the plane y equals 1, and this parabola shifted down 4 units is happening in the plane y equals 2. So what we have here are downwards opening parabolas for the x cross sections, upward opening parabolas for the y cross sections. If you look at z cross sections, you're actually going to get hyperbola for x and y. It's kind of opening like this, like a hyperbola shape. You piece it all together, and you get what we call a hyperbolic paraboloid. The difference between this picture and this picture is that this x-axis is going to be rotated. So it still satisfies the right-hand rule, but here's my positive x-axis and here's my positive y-axis. So this is a hyperbolic paraboloid. It's sometimes called a saddle surface because of the way it bends up. Like here's the pommel of the saddle, here where your stirrups would be. This shape is also like a Pringles chip, right? So if you're eating a Pringles chip, it goes up in one direction, it goes down in the other direction. It's a real-life application of hyperbolic paraboloids is snack design. And it's another example of a quadric surface. Let's work through our last example that we're going to do with cross sections before I show you all of the quadric surfaces together. So now consider the equation x squared plus y squared minus z squared equals 1. If I let x equal 0, y squared minus z squared equals 1 is a hyperbola. If I let x equal plus or minus 1, we actually get a special result. You plug plus or minus 1 in for x, the 1's cancel out and you get either z equals y or z equals negative y. So you get a pair of straight lines that look like this. And then when x equals plus or minus 2, we get another hyperbola opening in the opposite direction compared to the first one. Here are a few more x cross sections. So overall, the shape is hyperbolic for y and z. Similar story for the y cross section. So when y equals 0, we get this kind of hyperbola. When y equals plus or minus 1, we're going to get a pair of straight lines, and then our hyperbola are going to switch directions. But overall, we get this family of hyperbola. If you plug in z equals 0, we get our familiar unit circle in the xy plane. And then for other values of z, we go up and down the z-axis and our radius goes out. Okay, you piece it all together and it looks really messy, but this is all of the cross sections I just created, all put on the same picture. What this is tracing out is called a hyperboloid. More specifically, it's called a hyperboloid of one sheet. You'll see a hyperboloid of two sheets in a second. So here's a nice image of a hyperboloid. Viewed from the side, you can see this hyperbolic relationship. Viewed from above, we have this circular relationship. Those are the shapes that came out of the cross sections. I'll leave you to investigate the other quadric surfaces with cross sections on your own, but here's a chart of the six quadric surfaces. One that we didn't talk about is an ellipsoid, for which the sphere is a special example. Then we saw paraboloids, we saw cones, we just saw a hyperboloid of one sheet. Here's a hyperboloid of two sheets. So it's kind of similar, but because the right-hand side switched from 1 to negative 1, we can no longer have z values close to 0, because then we would get a sum of squares being a negative number. So that's what causes the sheet to break into two pieces. And then we did see the hyperbolic paraboloid. So you want to know all of these shapes. These are classic shapes, and you want to understand why they look the way they do. They are not all graphs of functions. So which ones are? The paraboloid could be treated as the graph of a function, z equals f of x and y, as can the hyperbolic paraboloid, because both of these pass the vertical line test for z. To each pairing of x and y coordinates, there's exactly one z coordinate. However, the ellipsoid, the hyperboloid of one and two sheets, and the cone are not functions of the form z equals f of x and y. So as we learn how to visualize equations in R3, try to distinguish when you're actually graphing a function, like we saw in the previous lecture, versus when you're graphing an equation. So these four quadric surfaces I just mentioned, in this diagram, I've graphed their equations, but I haven't graphed a function. Ultimately, what we're most interested in working with for the rest of this unit is functions, but I do want you to be familiar with quadric surfaces. Thank you for your attention.